to come. The cross before me, my hope on things above. And in you, Jesus, the best is yet to come. It's your presence, Jesus. Your presence is an open door.
Thank you.
worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. The name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Let's say holy and holy. There is no one like. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. You are whole. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
With your heart and lead me in your love.
it all. Over the universe and over every heart, there is no higher name. Jesus, you reign.
Come on, church.
Oh, let all of heaven and the earth erupt in song. Sing hallelujah to the everlasting one. There is no higher name.
Thank you for this wonderful time of worship, that we can spend some time with you and love on you, God. Let's just take a moment to greet each other and take our seats.
Everyone, we're so glad you're joining us, whether you're with us online or in person. Here are a few things you need to know. There are a lot of great things happening at Harvest Time. Here are a few ways you can get involved right now. To check out all things that are going on, scan the QR code or visit hdchurch.com.
If you'd like to give, you can visit us at hdchurch.com, click on Give at the top of the page, or use our Realm Connect app to set up reoccurring giving, or give at any time using the Harvest Time offering envelopes.
We have so many amazing opportunities to believe, belong, and be light. For more information on all things Harvest Time, meet us at the Connect Desk. We love you, Harvest Time Church, and have an amazing week.
Good morning, Harvest Time Church. How y'all doing? You excited to be in the house of God this morning? I know I say that every week, but are you really excited to be here? It's good to see everybody. I'm going to go straight into the announcements because we got a lot of important things to let you know about. And the first one is this. How many of y'all have ever been a part of our choir here at Harvest Time Church? Well, then guess what? I'm excited to have you guys sign up and be a part of our choir, which is back, and it's going to be debuting, if you want to say it like that, on Good Friday. We want you to be a part. If you love to sing, if you think you can sing, if you can't sing but you can smile, welcome to the choir. You're officially hired. We want to see you there. Go ahead and scan that QR code, or you can talk to us over at the Connect Desk right after the service, but we want to get you signed up. We're going to have rehearsals that are going to be kicking off soon, and it's going to be a whole heck of a lot of fun, and we would love for you to be there. Second thing I need to let you know about, if you're new to Harvest Time Church, maybe you're recently been coming, maybe you're just going, you know what, I've been coming for a while, but I want to call this my home church. Tonight at 6 p.m. in our Phase 1 Chapel, we are having a membership class, and we want to see you there. This is a great time to meet with Pastors Glenn and Denise and hear about where we've come from, but more importantly, where we're going as a church and how you can be a part of being a member of Harvest Time Church. We'd love to see you there. 6 p.m. tonight, you can scan that QR code if you'd like, or you can talk to us at the Connect Desk right after the service. If you're like, you know what, I don't like talking to people and I don't like electronics, we'll just see you at 6 p.m. over at Phase 1 Chapel. We'll talk to you from a distance at another time. But we'd love to see you there. It's a great way to find out really the heart of what we believe as a church and how you can be a part of that. So that's tonight at 6 p.m. Also want to let you know, next Friday night, we're having a fire in the night worship and prayer and baptism party extravaganza. We could say extravaganza, Pastor Glenn. Can't we say that? Fire in the night extravaganza? It's just going to be a great time. If you have not been baptized, or maybe you were baptized when you were younger, but you know that maybe that's what your parents wanted. I got baptized when I was 14, followed Jesus for 14 minutes, and then decided when I was 30 it was time to get baptized. And really, that was my decision to do that. But if maybe that's you and you go, you know what? I want to make that outward expression of an inward decision to follow Jesus and to declare in front of my friends and families, then this is a great time for you. Come to the Connect Desk right after the service. Talk to myself, Pastor Kim, Pastor Nick. We'd love to get you signed up and baptized next Friday night. It's going to be a great time, and you do not want to miss it. So if you have any questions, we'll meet you at the Connect Desk, let you know any information about our church, life groups, HTU, anything that's happening. We want you to be a part of it. So really quickly, before we continue on with our service, I want to come and talk around our giving. Thank you so much to everybody who gives week in and week out. Can we give a big shout out to everybody who's watching us online, HT Church YouTube page? Hey, make sure you subscribe. If you're new and you're watching us right now, hit that subscribe button so that way you can find out how anytime we go live, it'll come up in your feed. Love having you a part of our HTC online community. There's going to be a link that you can click to give that way. Also, if you got this in your program, you can give this way. Make sure you fill out all of that information and put that three-digit code on the back if you're using a credit card. You can also give by text, which is really easy. You can give online as well. But I want to encourage you with something that Jesus says. He says this, it is more blessed to give than to receive. How many of y'all just like doing what Jesus says? How many of you just feel good being obedient? How many of you know that this moment right here is an opportunity to continue to step out in obedience and also put to test the words of Jesus? How many of you know when he says something, you can stand on that? And I love in these moments right here, we can understand that it is a blessing and we are more blessed when we give than when we receive. And we come around our tithes and offerings, it's just an opportunity to continue to give first and give back what God has given us. So as we do that, let's be expectant, let's be excited, let's be joyful as we give and stand in expectation and give with the anticipation that God is going to continue to take his gospel further through the local church in a place like this in the surrounding area. Amen? Why don't you hold your gift in your hand as we pray? Hold your spouse's hand. Hold your friend's hand. Maybe you're sitting next to somebody, you've been trying to get that hand. Maybe this is a good excuse to get that hand. Let the Holy Spirit move. Jesus, we love you. Lord, we thank you that we give with a sense of joy. Lord, we give with a sense of expectation, anticipation to see your gospel go further in this region. Lord, we thank you that you use us very fallible, imperfect people to take your kingdom forward through our finances. So, Father, we thank you for this opportunity. Lord, bless what is brought in, supernaturally multiply it. Lord, bless the families that are in here that are giving each week and continuing to be a part of the story of you. Jesus, we love you, and it's in your name we pray. Amen. Why don't you turn your attention to the screen?
Just one word. You calm the storm that surrounds me. Just one word. The darkness has to retreat. Oh, just one touch. I feel the presence of heaven. Just one touch. My eyes were open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that he can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that
God bless you. Good morning, everyone. So glad that you joined us for worship today. Didn't our worship team do an awesome job leading us this morning? You have your Bible or your Bible app, find Matthew chapter 16. Matthew chapter 16, going to start reading in verse 13. Want to talk to you today for a few minutes about a heart revelation of Jesus, a heart revelation of Jesus, Matthew 16. While you're finding way there, I noticed something on the slide about fire in the night. It said 6 p.m. soaking. That's not the baptism, okay? That's soaking prayer at 6 p.m. We will soak you if you're getting baptized, but we'll do it a little bit later. Soaking prayer at 6, and then worship begins at 7. Listen, if you've never been baptized since you've become a follower of Jesus, you don't have to pray about doing it. You just need to do it. So you never have to pray about doing what God told you to do. So you pray about it anyway, but if you'd like to be water baptized, follow Jesus in obedience, we'd be happy to share that with you Friday evening. All right, Matthew chapter 16, going to start in verse 13. The Bible says, when Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do people say the Son of Man is? They replied, some say John the Baptist, others Elijah, still others, Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. But what about you? He asked, who do you say that I am? May I tell you, that is the most important question ever. Simon Peter answered, you're the Messiah, the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Then he ordered his disciples not to tell anyone he was the Messiah. Let's talk about a heart revelation of Jesus. I want to start with a question today from the Holy Spirit. Have you received a heart revelation of Jesus? Jesus said, no one can come to me unless my Father who sent me draws him. When it comes to saving faith, information and speculation will always bring us up short of the destination. Only a heavenly revelation of Jesus can bring about a radical saving transformation. This was the experience of St. Paul on the Damascus Road. Paul wrote, God, who said in the beginning, let there be light in the darkness, has made his light to shine in our hearts so that we could know the glory of God to be seen in the face of Jesus Christ. Paul was one of the most brilliant Jewish scholars of his day, but it wasn't study and intellectual inquiry that brought him to his moment of saving faith. It was a revelation that came from heaven. My question for you today is, have you had such an experience? Might not have been as dramatic as St. Paul's, probably wasn't, but the impact on your life is just as life-changing. Have you received a heart revelation of Jesus? Since last year, we've been looking at the most wonderful life of all, the life of Jesus. We have followed Jesus through his first year of ministry around the Jordan River. We've followed Jesus through his second year of ministry of explosive popularity in Galilee. Now Jesus leads the disciples beyond Galilee, and he goes all the way to the northernmost point in Israel. Caesarea Philippi was built on a plain at the base of Mount Hermon, the tallest mountain in Israel. This is the furthest distance that Jesus traveled in his 33 years. And this is the beginning of the end. From here, Jesus begins his final journey to Jerusalem and to the cross. I find it significant that Jesus trekked all the way to the cross from the furthest distance possible in order to lay down his life as a sin offering. Jesus walked the entire length of Israel to save his people from their sins, and he goes to very great lengths to save each one of us. At Caesarea Philippi, Jesus poses two questions to his disciples. Who do people say that I am? And then, who do you say that I am? Peter boldly steps forward and he speaks on behalf of the group as he so often did. And he says, "You are the Christ, the Messiah, Son of the living God." This scene is famously called Peter's confession of Christ, or the confession at Caesarea Philippi. This is the decisive turning point in the story of Jesus. It's the first time that any person has acknowledged Jesus' true identity. Peter's confession brings an immediate, effusive response from Jesus. "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven." Peter's faith wasn't a result of his own inquiry or speculation. It was the result of a heart revelation from above. Looking at Jesus' words in Matthew 16, I want to share a few thoughts with you about what happens to us when we receive a heart revelation of Jesus. What happens to us when we receive a heart revelation? On your way in, you received a program. In your program, there's an outline of today's sermon. And if you'd like to listen, watch the screens, fill in the blanks, and follow along, you can do that. If you're joining us on live stream, we're so glad that you're worshiping with us today online. There is a link in the chat section of the live stream. You can click on that link and download a copy of today's sermon outline. I do want to say for all of our moms and dads that we do have nursery available in the other wing of the building. We also have some rooms in the back of the sanctuary. If your baby just wants to testify in the middle of the sermon, you can either go into one of those rooms in the back, or you're welcome to take your children downstairs, and we have great ministry for them in the children's wing. What happens to us when we receive a heart revelation of Jesus? Few thoughts. First of all, we become people of courageous conviction. We become people of courageous conviction. I find that most people today are a lot like the people of Galilee. They have good thoughts about Jesus, but not necessarily the right thoughts about him. Jesus' teaching and his miracles led people to conclude that he was a Jewish prophet on a return visit. They thought that Jesus was more of the same. They failed to recognize that Jesus was something absolutely different, unique, absolutely novel. Can I tell you, so many people in the world still think that way about Jesus. Their thoughts about Jesus are good, but they see him as more of the same. They lump Jesus together with other global spiritual figures and sages, Muhammad, Buddha, Dalai Lama, Confucius, Gandhi, or some guru. Listen, to call Jesus a prophet is not wrong, but it is certainly not enough. He is a prophet, but he is much more than a prophet. When you receive a heart revelation of Jesus, you will freely confess what others are reluctant to admit, and you will personally commit at levels where others refuse to follow. Somewhere along the way, in 2 years of following Jesus, Peter received a heart revelation. The Father disclosed to Peter Jesus' true identity. Many said Jesus was a prophet, but Peter boldly confessed, "No, you're the King." Christ is the Greek translation of the Hebrew word Messiah. It means the anointed King, the one sent by God to reclaim the throne of David and rule over Israel and the whole world. You see, as a prophet, listen, as a prophet, Jesus is very easy to live with, but a king is a whole nother issue. A king requires honor and obeisance. A king requires submission and loyalty. A king requires tribute. A king requires service and obedience. A prophet can be ignored, even silenced, but it's another matter to deal with a king. More than an earthly king, Peter confessed, Jesus is the Son of the living God. Doubtful that Peter even realized fully the significance of the words coming out of his mouth at that moment. Surely Peter and the rest of the apostles didn't fully understand the meaning of the Son of God until after the cross and the resurrection. But here's what Peter knew. Jesus is not just more of the same on the world stage of spiritual sages and leaders. Jesus has a unique relationship with God the Father, the living God, that sets him far apart and far above everyone else. That's good preaching, by the way. I just thought I'd point that out. You might be aware that my wife, Denise, is 100% Ukrainian. Denise's great-grandparents immigrated to Canada at the turn of the last century. Her grandfather came to Canada as a boy from Ukraine. My father-in-law's first language was Ukrainian. He didn't learn to speak English until he started school at the age of 8. Denise's dad and her uncles have been involved in missions to Ukraine for over 50 years. They run a large missions organization called the Masters Foundation, and I hope that as a congregation, when it's time to start sending support, we can help Ukraine through the Masters Foundation. They have boots on the ground and they know what to do. We've been on several missions trips across the years to Ukraine. We have precious friends in Christ there. We've been communicating back and forth with them over the last several days. Let me tell you something, being married to a Ukrainian, I want to tell you, they're tough. We're going to pray for Ukraine at the end of our service, but I'm just so proud of President Volodymyr Zelensky. He refuses to desert his people. He's committed to his nation even to death. And may I just say that as a believer, that is precisely the kind of courageous conviction that we need about Jesus. All the others say that Jesus is just one more of the same, but we have received a heart revelation from the Father. We confess that Jesus is the King of Kings, and he shall reign forever and ever. We confess that Jesus is the Son of the living God. He is not like anyone else who has ever crossed the world stage. He has a totally unique relationship to God. He is God, and we will cling to our confession of Jesus even to the death. You see, when you receive a heart revelation of Jesus, it causes a heart revolution. Congratulations, you are all Jesus revolutionaries. What happens to us? You know, I always start slow and then I get going, so here we go. What happens to us when we receive a heart revelation of Jesus, courageous conviction? Here's another thought. This is good right here. We discover, this is not a shouting part, but it's a good part. We discover our God-given identity. Beloved, listen to me. Discovering Jesus' identity is the key to discovering our own identity. Something amazing happens. The moment that Peter correctly identifies Jesus, Jesus wheels around and he reveals Peter's true identity. Peter said, "I know you, Jesus. You're the Son of the living God." And Jesus replied, "I know you too, Simon. You're the son of Jonah." When you receive a heart revelation of Jesus, you enter into a new intimate friendship with him. You have the wonderful realization that Jesus knows you. He knows your father. He knows your family. He knows where you're from. He knows what you do for a living and what you do for fun. He knows your character. Jesus knows me. This I love. Listen, Jesus also knows your weak points. And sometimes he's a little lovingly playful with you in addressing them. Peter's given name was Simon, which means to hear. But for a guy whose name means to hear, he wasn't a very good listener all the time. He was too quick to speak. And Jesus plays with that a little bit. He gives Peter a nickname. Jesus knows your weaknesses, but he also knows, listen, your redemptive identity. He knows what you are destined to become in him. I know you, Simon, son of Jonah. You're not always such a good listener, but now I tell you that you are Peter, a rock. Jesus is giving Peter his new identity. Your family knows you as this. Your friends know you as this. Your coworkers know you as this. Your community knows you as this. You know yourself as this. But I tell you that you are not any of that. You are this. You are a rock. The Bible says in the book of Revelation that God has already picked out a forever nickname for you. It's not a name associated with any of the failures of your past or even the struggles of your present. It's a name associated with your redemptive identity in Christ. That's the name that God forever knows you by and calls you by. Fear not, for I am with you. I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You're mine. And when you pass through the waters, I'll be with you. The rivers, somebody hear me today, somebody listening, the rivers will not overwhelm you. The rivers will not overwhelm you. The rivers will not overwhelm you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. I feel like I have a word for somebody listening today. I don't know whether you're here in this sanctuary or whether you're tuned in online, but here's the word of the Lord. You are not who your father or your family said you are. You are not who your friends said you are. You are not who your former employer said you are. You are not who your critics say that you are. You are not who your therapist says that you are. Somebody, listen to me. You are not who your feelings say that you are. That's good right there. This is from the Lord. Feelings are tricky things, aren't they? Feelings act like facts, but they're not facts. You are not who your feelings say you are. You are who God says you are. And he has the final word on you. I know you too, Simon, son of Jonah. You're not always such a good listener. But I tell you, you are a rock in me. What happens when we receive you? Doing all right this morning? Get you anything? A little coffee, tea? All right, you ready to go on? What happens to us when we receive a heart revelation of Jesus? Courageous conviction, God-given identity. Here's another one. I like this. We achieve productive stability. So I've learned something about highly gifted people. They're capable of accomplishing amazing things. And they are also a pain in the neck. King Solomon said, where there is no oxen, the stall is clean, but much profit comes by the strength of an ox. How many of you ever worked with highly gifted people? Everybody that I've ever worked with here at Harvest Time is smarter than me, and I'm not even joking about that. I don't know how I ended up the ringleader. It's just the way God made it happen. When working with highly gifted people, there are certain junctures at which One questions whether their giftedness is really worth the mess there is to shovel. Peter was an ox. Peter was capable of amazing things, but he also left behind some mighty big messes to shovel. Who else walked on water? Who else confessed Christ? Who else said, "Lord, I'll follow you to the death," and then drew a sword to defend Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane? And who else needed to be rescued from the waves? And who else was rebuked harshly by Jesus as an agent of Satan? And who else denied Jesus three times in the high priest's courtyard? But this is what we learn from Peter, that a heart revelation of Jesus produces a radical character transformation. Somebody, I have a word from the Lord for you. The Lord says, more strength, less mess. More strength, less mess. More strength, less mess. These few verses in Matthew 16 are some of the most hotly debated verses in the New Testament. My friend, Father Chris Lighton from St. Paul's Church in Darien, was here in the early service. If I knew he was coming to the 9 o'clock, I would have made him get up and explain them. Who or what is this rock upon which Jesus builds his church? Some people believe that it is Peter exclusively. Some people believe that it is Peter along with the other New Testament apostles and prophets. Some people believe the rock is Jesus, and I want to tell you their arguments are very convincing. I'm almost persuaded. But I like to think about it this way. A heart revelation of Jesus transforms us into something stable that God can work with in the world. Jesus was a builder. You ever try to build something on an unsteady surface? You ever try to build on an unsteady ground? Or ever try to do carpentry, to cut wood on an unsteady work surface? It doesn't work. Who is the rock upon which Jesus is building his church? It's Peter. It's the rest of the first century apostles and prophets who laid the foundation of the church, St. Paul says to the Ephesians, and it's every believer who has received a heart revelation of Jesus from the Father that has radically transformed his or her character into something stable that God can work with in his world. That's good right there. I feel like God just wants to speak a word to somebody's heart. You are a highly gifted person, capable of amazing things, but sometimes you're a handful. Receive the word of the Lord. He is transforming you into something productively stable. More strength, less mess. More strength, less mess. I want you to say that with me. Come on. More strength. More strength. Less mess, more strength, less mess in Jesus' name. What happens to us when we receive a heart revelation? I'm in trouble now. We enter. This is good right here. I don't know whether you're going to go home happy today, but I'm going to go. I preach myself happy already, and I'm about to preach myself happy again. What happens when we receive a heart revelation of Jesus? We enter into our prophetic destiny. Peter, the fisherman from Galilee, was destined to become a fisher of men and the leading figure in the founding of the early church. I tell you, Peter, a rock. You are a rock, and on this rock I will build my church, and I will give to you the keys of the kingdom. After the resurrection, Jesus charged Peter three times, "Feed my sheep, feed my sheep, feed my sheep." On the day of Pentecost, it was Peter who, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, stood up and preached a sermon interpreting what God was doing in that moment, and Peter opened the door of salvation to the Jewish people. Philip evangelized the Samaritans, but then Peter came down from Jerusalem and laid his hands on them, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit, and the door of salvation was opened to the Samaritans. Peter preached in a Roman centurion's living room, and a group of Gentiles were filled with the Holy Spirit, and the door of salvation was opened to the Gentile world. Peter's prophetic destiny was to be a door opener, and that is our destiny too. We're destined to become part of the door-opening ministry of the church in the world. The keys that Jesus has given us is the gospel. When we tell the story of Jesus, when we lay hands on the sick and they recover, when we lay hands on the oppressed and they're set free, when we serve in the love of Jesus, we open the door and give people access to eternal life. That's good right there. We usher them into the dominion of King Jesus. We open the door for people to have their own heart revelation about Jesus. No, Jesus, you are not just more of the same. You are not just another prophet or sage on the world stage. You're the King. You're my King. Congratulations. Now you know your life's calling. It's to be a door person. Beloved, listen to me. When you help build the church in any and every way that you do, you are opening the door for people to know Christ. When you showed up for worship today, you were contributing to the door-opening ministry. When you came to serve today, when you came to love your brothers and sisters, when you came to pray and receive the word of God, you are participating in the door-opening ministry of the church. A single day in your courts, O Lord, is better than 1,000 elsewhere. I would rather be a, come on, who knows it? I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to live lavishly with the wicked. What happens when we receive a heart revelation of Jesus? Courageous conviction, God-given identity, productive stability, prophetic destiny. Here's another part. I like it. We operate in heavenly authority. I tell you, you are Peter, a rock, and on this rock I will build my church. I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Now, I want you to stay with me, because this is the part that requires a little extra listening. Jesus' church not only operates the door on earth into the kingdom, but we live and we function within that sphere of authority. Let me say it again, and then I'm going to illustrate it so you get it. I don't want you to miss it. We operate the door into the kingdom, and then we ourselves exist, we live, and we function with what's on the inside, inside the sphere of Jesus' authority. Let me illustrate. Our church building is located in Greenwich, Connecticut. This morning, Justice and JP and Pastor Kimmy came early, and they unlocked all the doors and they opened them so that y'all could come in and worship. And now we're worshiping together inside the building. Geographically, we are in Greenwich, but the conditions in here are different than the conditions in the rest of Greenwich this morning. Stay with me. It's 33 degrees all over Greenwich this morning, but it's 70 in here, maybe a little warmer. There's a west wind blowing at 10 miles an hour in Greenwich this morning, making it feel like 23, but in here it feels like 70. We're right next door to the airport. Planes are taking off at 120 plus decibels, but we don't hear them in here. Tonight, the sun will go down in Greenwich at about 5:45, but the lights in here will remain on constantly. HTC is in Greenwich, but we came in through open doors, and what we experience in here is different from the conditions in the rest of Greenwich. Are you with me? That's exactly how it is with Jesus' church in the world. We are in the world, but we have passed through open doors into the kingdom, into the sphere of God's reign and authority, so that the conditions we experience in Christ in the world are something different, something better than what everyone else is experiencing out there. This is good stuff right here. Let me tell you something. This is so good, you're going to have to listen to it again. Now, let's talk about binding. If I haven't lost you already, now I'm really going to lose you. Let's talk about binding and loosing for a moment. Binding and loosing refers to the authority of Jewish rabbis to determine what is permissible and what is forbidden within their jurisdiction. I'm from Pennsylvania. Anybody else from Pennsylvania here? Any other fellow Pennsylvanians? I got a couple. Oh yeah, my friend Brian. We grew up just a few miles from each other. So in Pennsylvania, there are many different orders of Amish and Mennonites. And in each district, the elders determine what is permissible and what is forbidden. In some districts, cars are forbidden altogether. In other districts, cars are permissible, but all the chrome has to be painted black. They're called black bumper Mennonites. In other districts, cars with chrome are perfectly fine. That is an example of binding and loosing. How many old school Catholics do I have here this morning? Old school. All right, my old school Catholics, do you remember back in the days when you weren't supposed to eat meat on Fridays? Did you remember that? That was to honor the sacrifice of Christ who offered his flesh on Good Friday. But after Vatican II, the rules all started to change. I have a friend who lived here in Connecticut, and he moved to a new house. He lived on one side of the Connecticut River, and he moved to a new house on the other side of the river. And when he moved to the new house, he was in a new diocese. And so in the old diocese, the bishop said, "Thou shalt not eat meat on Friday." But in the new diocese, the bishop said, "Eat, drink, and be merry." That is binding and loosing. You got it? You with me? So what's the meaning for us? Jesus has given his church the keys to the kingdom of heaven. We have opened the doors, and now we exist within the sphere of his dominion. And Jesus has delegated authority to us to bind and to loose, to determine what is permitted and what is forbidden. It's 33 degrees outside today with a wind chill of 23, but we have a thermostat that allows us to make it 70 in here. There's 120 decibels next door at the airport, but we have the ability to make it 60 decibels in here, or maybe a little more. Now let's make that spiritual. There's rampant anxiety out there, but Jesus has given us the authority to live in an atmosphere of heaven's peace. There's runaway anger out there, but Jesus has given us authority to live in an atmosphere of heaven's joy. Bondage to addiction is an epidemic out there, but Jesus has given us the authority to live in freedom. Whoever sins is a slave to sin, but whom the Son sets free is free indeed. There's sickness out there, but there's healing in here. People are harassed and oppressed by the enemy out there, but Jesus has given us authority over serpents and scorpions and over all the works of the enemy in here. I looked that up, Renee. It means all the works of the enemy. Are you with me? I wish I had time to preach about this. Something happens when the Church of Jesus Christ gathers together for worship and prayer. God said, "I am there in the midst of them." Together in his presence, we come into alignment with his will, and we come into agreement with his authority, and supernatural things begin to happen. Now I have a word for all you Facebook decreers and declarers. I love you, But you know, Jesus sometimes played a little bit with his disciples on the point of their weakness. There's something important you need to know before you go around decreeing and declaring. The English translation of Jesus' words are a little bit imprecise here. Actually, our friend Pastor Brian Simmons does an amazing job translating these verses in the Passion Translation. You should read it. What Jesus actually says is, whatever you bind on earth will have already been bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth will have already been loosed in heaven. So listen. It's not like I make a decree on earth and heaven responds accordingly. I don't tell God what to do. He makes decisions in heaven and I come into agreement with them down here on earth. This is good preaching right here. Listen. The Holy Spirit guides us in our binding and loosing so that we can bring down heaven's atmosphere and see God's will done here on earth. And that happens in here, in the assembly, wherever believers, it can be in a church building or a living room, it doesn't matter, but it happens where Jesus, believers are gathered together and the authority of Christ is there. So before you go decreeing and declaring all over the place, you best get yourself in a body of Spirit-filled believers and get the mind of Christ. I want to push you a little bit today. I'm going to go long and I don't care. I want to push back on a trend in the American church today. Listen to me, somebody. Listen, you are not an audience. We are not performers up here on the stage, and you are not spectators down there taking in the show. Jesus said, I will build my church. We have been drawn in by the Father. We are recipients of heavenly revelation. That doesn't make us better than anyone else. It does make us blessed, Jesus said. We all belong to Jesus. We're His people. We're entrusted to be doorkeepers, admitting people into eternal life, and we're authorized to bring heaven's atmosphere and God's will down here to earth. You are not an audience. We're not going to ever treat you like an audience. Whenever we gather together, all of us are here to transact holy spiritual business, and every one of us is integral to that. What happens when we receive a heart revelation of Jesus? Believe it or not, we're almost done. Worship team, come rescue me. What happens when we receive a heart revelation of Jesus? We're guaranteed certain victory. Simon, I tell you, you are Peter, a rock. And on this rock, I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will never prevail against it. Here's what you need to know about the church. And listen, when I say church, I don't mean a building. I mean God's people, wherever and however and whatever we're gathered together. Here's what you need to know. We're called by Him. We're owned by Him. We are built by Him. We are commissioned by Him. We are authorized and empowered by Him. And listen, we are sustained by Him. The gates of hell is Old Testament language for death. On the brink of death, King Hezekiah cried out to the Lord, Lord, in my prime, must I go through the gates of Hades? Must I experience death? The gates of hell shall not prevail against the church, means that the church will never be swallowed up in death. The threat of death will not destroy the church. The fear of death will not destroy the church. The pangs of death will not destroy the church. Communism will never destroy the church of Jesus Christ. President Putin and President Xi and Kim Jong-un, they will never, 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 never destroy the Church of Jesus Christ. Russian tanks and planes and artillery will never destroy the church. Government prohibitions will never destroy the church. Religious persecution will never destroy the church. Philosophy will never destroy the church. Critical theory can't touch this. Secular humanism can't touch this. Globalism, we're like whack-a-mole. Hit us over there, we're going to pop over here. Hit us over here, we're going to pop up back over there again. Every other ism in history will become a wasm sooner or later, but the Church of Jesus Christ will always be. Someone receive this last word and we're done. Somebody hear me, hear me, hear me. Somebody, death is trying, a death spirit is trying to take you. It's trying to take you out. You hear me. Hear me speak the word of God. Because we belong to the living God. Death does not and cannot have the final word on us. No one comes to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up on the last day. Have you received a revelation of Jesus? Stand on your feet and give the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords a great big praise in this place today. Oh, come on, don't give him a wimpy little praise. Let's give Jesus a great big praise. Come on, lift him up. Clap your hands. All ye people, shout unto God with a voice of triumph. Come on, lift up your hands. Lift up your faces. Lift up your voices. Let's declare the dominion of the Lord. You reign above it all. You reign above it all. Come on, let's sing. There is no higher name, Jesus, you reign above all. Let all the heaven and the earth erupt in song. Sing hallelujah to the everlasting one. There is no higher name, Jesus, you reign above it all. Just one moment, we're all going to gather together and we're going to pray for Ukraine. We're going to pray for Russia. We're going to pray for the world. I asked the worship team especially to do that song, You Reign Above It All, to remind us all that God's still on his throne. Just before we do that, I want to invite you, if you're willing, symbolic, but if you're willing, would you put your hand over your heart? And I just want to pray for you. Father, I pray that every person, Lord, you have given to us, the church, assembled together, you've given us the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Lord, you've given us, Lord, the ability to give access to eternal life and to the dominion of Jesus Christ. Father, I pray that every person, every man, every woman, every child, every teenager, every young adult, every not so young adult, let every person, every English speaker, every Spanish speaker, every Portuguese speaker, Lord, everyone listening online, pray that every person would have a heart revelation of Jesus. Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, Lord, let your light shine in darkened hearts. God, who said, let there be light, cause the light of revelation to shine right now in hearts to know the glory of God that's seen in the face of Christ. I wonder if, while your heart is still over your hand, I wonder if you would just make a confession of faith. Jesus is not a prophet. He's not more of the same. He's unlike any other figure that has ever crossed the world stage. I wonder if you'd make Peter's confession for yourself while your hand is on your heart. Just say this with me. Jesus, you are the Christ, the Messiah, the King, Son of the living God. Jesus, you're my King. Come on, give him praise, would you? Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Now listen, we're gonna pray for Ukraine together. We didn't do this in the first, we prayed in the first service, but we didn't have time to do this in the first service, but we have time to do it in this service. We're gonna sing that song again, You Reign Above It All, but we're gonna change the words, and we're gonna sing You Reign Above Ukraine. You Reign Above Ukraine. Are there any, besides my wife, are there any other, we had some Yukis in the first service. Are there any Ukrainians here? Any Ukrainians here in the service? We had several in the okay, you're all Italians in here. This is what I want to invite you to do. If you're willing, would you step out of your seat, and we're going to make this altar a place of prayer. We're going to do what the church is authorized to do. We're going to sing, You Reign Above Ukraine, You Reign Above Ukraine, and we're just going to declare it, and then we're going to pray together. Come on, lift up your voice. If you're willing, come join us down here at the front. Let's sing. Hallelujah. Come on, give the Lord a good praise. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Pastor Nick and Patty, come and join me if you would, please. Because we have friends on the ground in Ukraine, we've been in communication with them over the last several days. My heart is just so broken for moms and kids hiding in basements and subway tunnels, and for dads kissing their fathers goodbye. My translator in Ukraine, Sergei, drove his family to a farm, and he said to me, "Pastor Glenn, I'm headed back to Kiev to report for military service. They said that the Russian troops, they're boys that were drafted." How many of you know God loves Russia too? He loves the Russian people. The people are out on the streets in St. Petersburg and Moscow getting arrested for defying Putin. And the Russian troops are boys, and they have peach fuzz on their faces. They have cell phones in their pockets with TikTok on it, just like any of our sons. And they don't even know what's going on. They were told they're going on a training mission. They didn't even know they were being sent into combat. Putin has brought Chechenian troops that are committing unspeakable, barbaric atrocities. I can't even tell you the things that the reports that we heard yesterday from the eastern part of Ukraine. But how many of you know that we're not powerless? I give to you the keys of the kingdom, and whatever you bind on earth will have been bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will have been loosed in heaven. Listen, if you have a heavenly prayer language, I want you to lift up your face, lift up your hands to the Lord, and we're going to pray in tongues, because praying in tongues brings us into agreement with the will. The Holy Spirit's our prayer partner, and He brings us into agreement to pray in alignment with the Word of God. I want us to lift up our voice. I want us to just begin praying in a heavenly language. If you don't have one, just pray in the language that you know, and let's just begin to call out, and then Pastor Nick's going to lead us in prayer. Come on, everybody, lift up your hands, lift up your faces, lift up your voices. Let's pray. Shakaraba sikiando rabasuka perea masuta labagaba sitiata sote andarabaka sukurababa sitiata rabake siki uro karababa shandarabala mande arababa. Come on, church, would you press in for just a moment? If you have a prayer language, just let's make intercession right now in this spirit for Ukraine and for Russia and for Europe. Karabaka sataya mama masutura baba suku uroba baba la baba ba shiti andoro raba la baba 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 sikia baba ba kotara mama mahalama shiti andara baga siti kura baba ba shatara bala baba baba la baba baba ba shiti andara bala ba sata.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Father, we come before you right now as priests of your kingdom, Lord, commissioned, Lord, authorized by you, Lord, to be door openers, Lord. Father, we pray for your mercy today, God. Lord, we pray for your mercy for the nation of Ukraine, Lord God. And we pray for your mercy for the nation of Russia. Father, we pray, Lord, that your sweet, precious Holy Spirit would sweep over Ukraine and sweep over the region right now. God, we pray that you would paralyze, Lord, all that have come to do harm, all that have come to kill and slaughter and to terrorize. Paralyze them, God, right now in the name of Jesus. Freeze them in their tracks. God, would you release angelic miracles right now, Father, to bring deliverances for your people, Father. Lord, strengthen the hands of the church in Ukraine, Lord, as they pray, as they cry out to you, God, on this Lord's Day. Lord, let the heavens open over them, Father. Lord, and send relief, send your mercy, send your angels, Father God. Father, we ask for protection and mercy and grace, Lord. Lord, for those that are refugees, those that are traveling, Lord, those that are weak, those that are wounded, Lord, those that have been bereaved, Lord Jesus. Precious Good Shepherd, gather them to your heart, Lord Jesus. Release your comfort over that nation, Lord God. Release your comfort over that nation. Father, we pray that help of every kind would come, Lord God. Lord, that the hearts of people near and far would be stirred to give what help they can, Lord. Father, it's good to show moral support, but real support, God, where it's needed is what has to happen, Father. So raise that up, God, among the nations of the earth, Father. And Father, we pray for Russia, Lord, and we pray for the leadership of Russia and for the leadership of Ukraine. Father, your word commands us to pray for kings and for rulers and for all that are in authority, Father, so that people can live a quiet and a peaceable life in all godliness and sincerity. So Father, Lord, we pray for that leadership of Russia. We pray for hearts to change, for hearts to turn. Lord, your word says the king's heart, it's like water in God's hands, and he turns it in whatever direction he desires. So Lord, turn the hearts of all that leadership there, God, in the name of Jesus. Turn the heart in the ways of righteousness. Father, we pray that all across the Slavic nations, God, that you would release a precious outpouring of your Holy Spirit, the likes of which has never been seen in history, God. Lord, that out of this, God, that you would redeem, that out of this would come a tremendous outpouring of your Spirit that will shake the nations. God, in every place where bombs and rockets have shook the earth, God, we pray that your Holy Spirit would shake the area and let it go to the nations, Father. Faithful. You're a faithful God. Lord, and we thank you that you show yourself faithful to your people, God, in this hour of need and crisis, God. And we bless you in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Father. Come on, church, say this with us: in Ukraine as it is in heaven. Come on, in Ukraine as it is in heaven. In Russia as it is in heaven. In Eastern Europe as it is in heaven. On earth as it is in heaven. Come on, say it. Jesus told us to pray it. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done. In Jesus' name. Come on, church, give him a good praise. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. If anybody would like to receive personal prayer, we have a prayer room across the foyer in that direction. Pastor Ruth and some of our friends will be there to pray with you. We have some outrageously good donuts downstairs if the greedy people in first service didn't eat them all. Come on, I want you to sing one more time before you go. You reign above Ukraine, and then you can be dismissed. God bless you, everybody. God be with you.